Hello and welcome to Health Professional Radio. My name is Toby Longhurst and joining me in conversation today is Professor Marc Cohen. Professor Cohen is one of Australia's pioneers of integrative and holistic medicine and has made significant impacts on education, research, clinical practice and policy. He's a registered medical practitioner with degrees in Western medicine, physiology and psychological medicine, along with PhDs in Chinese medicine and biomedical engineering. Professor Cohen, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. I'm happy to be with you.
So today we want to talk about the sleep cycle and why so many of us are struggling to get enough sleep. The Australian Sleep Health Foundation suggesting that 1 in 3 people regularly struggle with their sleep. Why do you believe this is such a widespread problem?
Well, sleep is an essential human function, and we're still understanding, you know, the basis of sleep. So it's not totally understood, all the dynamics around sleep, but we know that, you know, sleep is, you know, very important for setting, you know, homeostatic processes, restorative processes, and that the demands on our waking life are increasing, and our circadian rhythms are becoming disrupted. Normally, humans are not nocturnal. You know, we sleep at night and we're awake in the day generally, and our body follow a circadian rhythm based on the sleep-wake cycle, and that's not just, you know, sleeping or waking. That's all our body rhythms, whether it's our cardiovascular function, our organ regulation, our digestion, all of these functions have this circadian rhythm. And that's controlled by the pineal gland through melatonin production. And there are many factors that can put that out. And one of the most obvious factors with daytime, nighttime is exposure to light. And we know that normally light or sunlight in the morning has more of the blue spectrum, and towards the evening is more of the red spectrum. And we know that blue light specifically will inhibit melatonin production. So just having a lot of artificial light at night can reduce melatonin production, and certainly the blue light from screens that everyone seems to be looking at for, you know, long hours every day can inhibit melatonin production. So that can actually throw out our normal wake sleep cycle. So that puts out our circadian rhythms, and that has implications not just for, you know, insomnia and sleeplessness and depression and other mood disorders, but a lot of physical disorders. Even melatonin has anti-cancer properties, and all of our organ functions can go out. So effect of light, but also then the effects of just stress, and that psychological stress that people have, so many stressors now on them with, you know, blasts of news and the demands of, you know, all social media and emails and work and family stress and financial stress and the stress of current events, that, you know, that can disrupt people's thought patterns and their, you know, wake day night cycle. And then other things that control circadian rhythms can be eating habits. People eat, you know, before they go to bed. That can throw things out. It's nice to have a break, to eat, not eat, you know, at least a few hours before you sleep. So while you're sleeping, you're not having to actively digest, and your body can actually, you know, go into a deep relaxation, and you have this restorative processes. So there's a lot of factors that throw people's sleep out. I mean, once your sleep is thrown out, you can have a whole lot of other things that can go wrong in terms of any other health condition you've got is much harder to treat.
You mentioned food there. I'm curious. The time that we eat is very important. Is there any research that shows us shows the effects of different types of food on our sleep?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the most obvious is, you know, things that contain caffeine. Caffeine will inhibit melatonin, and there are certain herbs that will increase melatonin, speaking sort of whether it's herbal or other you know, nutrients. I mean, high sugar food can, you know, impact on sleep. Caffeine is known to block adenosine receptors, which affects melatonin production. So, yeah, there's sort of things you can change in your diet to enhance sleep. But certainly the timing of food is really important, and that it's much better not to eat just before you go to bed.
You mentioned caffeine. It is the most obvious one. So many of us feel like we rely on coffee to get us through the day. When should we stop drinking coffee? Because I've heard so many different reports on this.
Yes, and there is a individual variation there. So some people can say, you know, they'll drink a cup of coffee and go to bed and they'll be fine. And other people, you know, they drink even a decaf coffee with a tiny amount of caffeine in it and, you know, they won't sleep for hours. So it is a personal variation. There's been a personal preference there. But certainly caffeine does have, a stimulant effect that, as I say, blocks adenosine and will, it enhances cognition, but it also enhances awareness and reduces sleep. Whereas, there's sort of herbs which you can have that can actually, act similar to melatonin and actually have a sedative effect.
So what type of herbs would we be looking at that can do this?
Passion flower, hops. There's, individual herbs, but there's also combinations. And probably the most researched combination it's a formulation called Redorman Fort. And that's a formulation called ZE91019, which is, and I think it's important to say with herbal formulations, to say, passion flower or hops or oats or different herbs have a sedative effect. A herb is, a type of plant, but you don't eat a type of plant. You eat actually a preparation of that plant that's grown in a particular way, harvested in a particular way and processed to get the preparation that you're actually using. Valerian's another one that's really commonly used, but there are different ways to grow and prepare and produce valerian with, hops and other ingredients that has a lot of variation in the effect. So I think if health practitioners are going to be prescribing herbs, it's nice to prescribe the ones that have clinical evidence on the particular preparation they're using, not just to say, I've written this massive textbook on herbs and natural supplements, and in that, we have chapters on each individual herb. But when you look at, and each individual herb will have a, traditional use and different preparations. But when you go into the clinical studies, they'll specify, and often they have a code name, or a code number like the ZE91019, which means that this particular preparation is what has been used in the clinical trials, and this is the evidence that's been obtained from specific research. So I think it's nice if you are going to prescribe herbs to, just like you would with any other prescriptions, to actually prescribe things that have specific evidence associated with them.
So what is how are herbs going to work? Do they work in the same way as traditional medicines will, or do they take a longer time to have an effect?
Well, herbs actually work different from traditional medicine, from pharmaceutical medicines, which generally have a single ingredient at a very precise dosage and have a specific, quite often strong biochemical or pharmacological effect. Herbs usually contain always contain a whole gamut of phytochemicals. So these are very complex chemical mixtures that come from plants that generally have a much more subtle effect in terms of it's not as dramatic, but also which means the side effects are not as dramatic, and often they take a little bit longer to have an effect. So whereas you might have a pharmaceutical preparation that you'd expect to affect within a few hours or days, if you're taking a herbal formula, you might take a few weeks for it to actually have a noticeable effect. Now, in terms of the pharmacological effect, a lot of pharmaceuticals come from herbs, but they're highly purified. We know that, say valerian and hops and this Redorman Fort preparation has a specific pharmacological effect, which can change the sleep-wake cycle. So it actually has an effect on the circadian rhythm by affecting melatonin. And it's similar to, it's actually the opposite effect of caffeine. So whereas caffeine will inhibit adenosine, Redorman may actually activate adenosine and stimulate melatonin production and have a sedative effect.
I was also very interested to read that 20% more women suffer insomnia than men. Do we have any ideas why this might be the case?
You know, it's very hard when you're looking at gender differences because there's so many other social and cultural effects that may be the case there. And I think it's also different according to ages. So, and I think with insomnia, it's also important to distinguish psychological effects. So insomnia is a very important factor in depression, but also insomnia has some physical causes like sleep apnea and other factors. So I think it's important to work out if there's any serious medical condition going on or psychological situation there, say depression, sleep apnea, and other conditions, and then see if there's some other specific treatment that are needed. But in terms of why women have more insomnia, I don't know if there's any specific gender difference in terms of hormonal responses. We know menopause affects sleep, so menopausal women have more problems with insomnia. There may be factors with the menstrual cycle, and it's interesting when you look at a lot of clinical research. Often they exclude women who are pregnant or women who are menopausal, and it's really hard to say on that data. But certainly, if women are taking care of kids and babies, that causes sleep disruption. So there are many sort of gender differences that, I wouldn't say that this is an inherent biological change. I think it's more social and cultural.
Yeah. Well, we all know how sluggish and horrible we feel when we're trying to function after a sleepless night. They're the shorter-term effects. A moment ago, you were mentioning longer-term effects such as depression. What are the other longer-term effects of insomnia and poor sleep?
Well, again, depends on why you're getting the poor sleep. But once you lose that restorative power of sleep, it's really hard for your general organ systems to maintain homeostasis. Your immune system and is not as functional, so you're more likely to get other health conditions becoming problematic. And that then adds, because if you don't sleep well, you become stressed, more anxious, more irritable, more restless, more likely to have accidents, more likely to fall, you're more likely to have mental agitation, so you're not going to be as effective with your job, and you're less likely to recover from a mild illness. So, it's this negative spiral that happens, whereas if you can improve sleep, you can enter with this virtuous cycle where if you're sleeping really well, even if you've got other health conditions going on, you're much better able to cope with them. Your flexibility of response, your homeostatic range increases when you can sleep well, and when you wake refreshed and you're not drowsy in the morning or groggy, and you're clear, and you have enhanced mood, and you feel better able to cope with the general stresses of life, which I mentioned are increasing for everybody.
Now, many of our listeners will be medical and health practitioners who are solely mm-hmm. trained in Western practices and approaches. Mm-hmm. When it comes to alternative approaches, many of them will come with a degree of uncertainty of where to get reliable advice, What advice can you offer them to find a balance between the two approaches and them being able to integrate them into their practices?
Well, I think there's an imperative now for any health practitioner, and certainly Western medical practitioners, which, I'm a Western-trained doctor, to actually include what were considered alternative approaches, because now there's really solid evidence that they're effective. And, I've written this massive book, Herbs and Natural Supplements, an Evidence-Based Guide, where we looked at 130 herbs and nutrients and went through all the clinical evidence and the research evidence. And there's a wealth of information just in the normal sources on, PubMed, Google Scholar, or the bibliographical databases, where you can see, double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled trials on herbal preparations. And that's why I was talking about Redorman Fort before, which is the formulation that has the clinical research performed on it. So it has, randomized, placebo, double-blind, controlled trials performed on that actual product. Now, even by saying that, a lot of clinical trials exclude pregnancy, they exclude menopausal women, they exclude people with other heart conditions, or trials are a very limited tool. But I think that's a really good place to start. So where is the clinical evidence? And you can go with looking up the evidence yourself. There, the company Flawless have a sort of the model where they only produce herbal medicines that have clinical data on their product. So their products all have, you know, published peer-reviewed clinical trials. So that's a really nice place to start for Western practitioners. And I think there's a moral and ethical imperative for doctors to look at this, because if they don't, they could be denying their patients a safe, effective treatment and potentially putting them in harm if they're using other treatments that have, you know, more potential side effects or maybe not as effective.
It's such a big question. It's something we could do an entire interview on, and hopefully maybe we can get you back on to talk about the link between Eastern and Western medicine.
And I think it's really overwhelming for practitioners, because there's so much information you need to know nowadays. And, you know, where do you look for that information? And it's really hard for any doctor to go to the original research data, because, you put in a search term on a bibliographical, PubMed or something, and just get inundated by studies. So it is a vexed issue of where do you get quality information that's digestible, and that how do you turn that into prescribing practices? So I think it's a really important issue to discuss. And that's where, going to high-quality brands that have, research on their particular products is a really good place to start.
Well, I hope one day we can get you back on to talk about it again. But unfortunately today, we're fast running out of time. But Professor Cohen, thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure. I'm really happy to be with you. And yeah, look forward to speaking again sometime.
I look forward to it. If you've just joined us on Health Professional Radio, you've just missed my conversation with Professor Marc Cohen, a lead researcher at the School of Health and Biomedical Sciences at Melbourne's RMIT University, who's been discussing natural ways that we can achieve better sleep. To hear the interview again, you can find it in its entirety on our website, hpr.fm, along with many other interviews from the world's leading health and medical experts. You can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, iTunes, and SoundCloud. My name is Toby Longhurst, and you've been listening to Health Professional Radio.
Thank you for listening to Health Professional Radio. We're very proud to be an independent broadcaster providing our content free of charge to you, the listener. One of the ways that we're able to remain free and independent is by having people like you become patrons. You can support Health Professional Radio simply by visiting hpr.fm and clicking the button that says Become a Patron. Your patronage of even just $1 a month lets us know that you're there, which in turn makes us more valuable to advertisers. And, of course, if you're able to afford more, then we would certainly appreciate the support. My name is Toby Longhurst from Health Professional Radio. Please visit hpr.fm, click the Become a Patron button, and support us if you can.